Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Global Radio and TV Live, and I am your host, Dr. Ravi. The number to call is 469-307-1642, 1642. We would like to thank our viewers in the United Kingdom, USA, India, Morocco, United Arab Emirates, Canada, Thailand, Japan, Ukraine, China, Korea, Brazil, and Iraq. Well, you know the drill by now. If you haven't heard from us, or if I haven't heard from your country, just drop us a note and we will include you in that list. Now, everybody in our audience know that we discuss primarily conspiracy theories and controversial topics. You know, as a scientist, I would like to make sure that we have complete scientific proof before we get into any of the conspiracy theories. You know, we discussed here about the existence of God, aliens, not the illegal aliens, but the real aliens from the outer space, and JFK assassination. You know, I am from Dallas, so we like to find out when JFK was assassinated, by whom. You know, it's still a controversy. Everything is, controversial or conspiracy theories, and there is extreme skeptics and firm believers. But today, our interview is another departure from the usual, and the topic is about the Tinsel Town. The famous movie director Martin Scorsese once said, "Cinema is a matter of what is in the frame and what is out." So in a few seconds, I will be out, and we are bringing into the frame a very talented Hollywood actor. His name is Vinicius Machado, who had acted in numerous movies and TV serials, and he was kind enough to spend a few minutes with our global audience today. And Vinicius, welcome to Global Radio and TV Live.
Thank you so much for having me. I am excited to be here, and I'm looking forward to the next hour.
Well, fantastic. You know, I think just relax and let's see how it goes. By the way, I forgot, there is something behind me. There is a Snapple bottle there. Maybe I should move that. But anyway, notwithstanding that, you got a beautiful home there. So is that your house?
Yes, it is. Thank you.
All right. So, you know, every immigrant, and I would imagine you were based upon your bio data, I noticed that you were born in Brazil.
That is correct. Niterói, Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, in a little city called Icaraí, right off of the Guaraná Bay. Right off of Niterói. And it's interesting because Rio de Janeiro is usually known to be, you know, the big, big city, but actually Rio de Janeiro is also a state and a city. So it depends. It's kind of like New York, depending on where you're talking about. So I'm from the city of Niterói, the state of Rio de Janeiro.
Very interesting. You know, there is a definite distinction between whatever else you know you're talking about. You know, I say I am from Dallas, but I'm not from Dallas. In fact, I'm from a small little town called Lucas. So there is a big, big difference. Even though I would like to claim myself as from Dallas, but I'm not. But anyway, that's a different story. Now, every immigrant who comes to this country, like myself and yourself, has a very fascinating immigration story to tell. And our audience would like to know, what is your story?
Yeah, so I was born and raised in Brazil. My dad's company at the time, way back in like 92, 93, relocated to a branch over in Orlando, Florida. So we moved there and, you know, we filed for the paperwork to become citizens. And after, it was a very rigorous and a difficult process, but it took us about 10 to 12 years to be able to get it. But I am a citizen of the United States of America, so that's it.
Oh, congratulations. You know, it is a great honor to be a citizen of this great country. And, you know, people like yourself and mine, we have come here with different dreams and we were able to achieve some of it. Some of them became nightmares, but, you know, that's how life goes, right?
Absolutely, yes. But, you know, for the most part, you know, we are very blessed just by being here.
Absolutely. I totally agree with you. Tell me, after you came to Florida and you went to school, then what was your first interaction with the movie or TV business, and how did you get involved?
Well, actually, I didn't get involved into the industry for quite some time. I was, as you can imagine, a soccer player being grown up in Brazil. I actually did capoeira too. I talk about soccer a lot, but capoeira was a huge part of my background as, being a Brazilian. And I don't know if you're familiar with capoeira. Do you know what capoeira is?
No, I'm a little bit familiar, not very much. Tell our audience exactly who he is.
Yeah, so capoeira is a Brazilian dance martial arts form. It was developed by two slaves who freed themselves by performing capoeira. What they did was they invented this martial arts form that looked more like a dance because they couldn't practice martial arts or anything like that that would give them any power to be able to free themselves. So they created this dance form called capoeira so that when the guards were looking, it looked just like they were dancing and goofing off and, but then when the guards would turn around, they would practice like spinning kicks and, punches and things like that. So they combined the art of dancing with martial arts together. And that's how they freed themselves. They migrated over to Brazil from Africa. And then in Brazil, it developed and it became what it is today. But I, grew up dancing capoeira. I was actually a professor. I've performed all over the world. I used to dance with Street Breaks, which is off of High Voltage Entertainment from Universal Studios Orlando. Was there for many years doing that, different performances in different places. Actually, as a matter of fact, on Nickelodeon, one of the TV shows that I was in, they wrote an entire episode around my dancing abilities as a capoeira performer. So it's a Brazilian dance martial arts form that I've been doing for such a long time. But to go back to your question, I was playing soccer and playing capoeira, and then in high school, I had to take an elective in class in school, and I didn't like drawing or anything like that, so I took drama. I liked being like the center of attention, in the class, goofing off, so I figured I might as well get a good grade for it. That was my rationale at the time.
Okay.
But one of the requirements for the class was that I had to audition for one of the school plays. I did. I got it. I got the leading role, and then everything else is just history now. I became an actor and left soccer, left capoeira, and so here I am today.
Excellent. So, Vinicius, I was going through some of your videos, and the Nickelodeon video that I was able to find, I don't think that has any dance moves. But I would like to show our audience. This is probably the early part of your career, is that correct? The one that I was going to show?
Yes.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, here is Vinicius Machado on Nickelodeon. Let's take a look.
I am embarrassed.
You? You're embarrassed?
My English is no good.
That's why you didn't speak. So you're not super cool?
I am cool. Just English no good. I'm not ready for marriage.
Right.
Well, there you go, ladies and gentlemen. Vinicius, now tell me about this, Vinicius. What is that exactly? How did you get into that role? And what led up to this particular Nickelodeon episode?
Well, it's funny because that was actually one of the first few auditions I got when I got out here, and it just opened up all the doors for me out here. And that was within the first 2 to 3 weeks of being out here for the first time. So it's pretty incredible. It was a guest starring recurring, became series regular, and the show was a hit in and of itself. So it was a blessing to be a part. That character was a foreign exchange student, having the difficulties of adapting to a new culture, a new language, obviously being from Brazil, So it was kind of like written for me. And Jennifer Mosley, the character you see being portrayed by Lindsay Shaw, who is the actress portraying that character, is having a crush on my character, Fame and Fortune. And so she's coming onto me hard and wanting to, start a relationship. But the English, the language barrier gets in the way, and we start to misunderstand and miscommunicate our intentions with one another, and it just becomes a very comical moment there. So it was pretty cool how she puts on different hair pieces. She's trying to tell me, she's willing to change and to do whatever, and I'm telling her I don't like hair. I'm sorry to say, I don't like it here. So.
I was not sure because I thought they were all different women because the hairstyle is so, because we were only looking at the hair because the hair is, you were not looking at her face at all. So I thought they were all different women. But of course, that's a very small clip for us to get any idea as to what the storyline is. Well, so that was very early part. And this, you said that after a few weeks, you got this part as a rehearsal or for audition. And then what happened?
Yeah, and then I got the role, and I worked on it all season three. And then from there, I just, kept getting other roles and just haven't stopped working. You get your years where it's a little less than others, but I've not had one year where I haven't worked. So I've been very, very blessed, and I'm very fortunate. I'm very grateful for it.
Well, that's very good. Now, in the meantime, you came here in the 90s,
Yes.
about roughly about 20 years ago,
Yeah.
and I noticed that you have already got married,
Yes.
and you have three beautiful children.
Three kids, yes, a
Very
full
nice,
house.
very nice. So, whenever our audience, whenever our guests bring up the issue of getting married and having children, the first question we ask them is, how did you meet your wife?
I met my wife through her sister, actually. My wife is actually, she also has a background in acting.
Okay.
So it's just a series of different circumstances and connections through people mutually, and then we met.
That's it, huh? As simple as that, huh? Very
As simple
interesting.
as that, yeah, it was.
So where are the kids now? Are they at school?
The kids are in school, yeah,
Oh,
all of
okay.
them.
All right, so otherwise, I would imagine they will be running behind you.
Oh my goodness, we wouldn't be able to be talking right now if they weren't here.
Well, as a matter of fact, in some of our shows, we found the kids, the dogs, the cats, the pets, everything will suddenly appear. So, what we normally do is, okay, put them on the show and see what happens next. That's what's making it very interesting. All right, now let's go back and look at something else. You have done this Nickelodeon, and then I was going to ask you about there was another, I don't know, I think it's a serial. It's called Dark Blue. What is Dark Blue exactly, and how you got involved?
Oh yeah, Dark Blue. I had a it was a very small role, but very prominent. He was sort of the instigator of the bunch. I played Jose Vargas on it, and I had actually a scene with actually a few scenes with Omari Hardwick, who I also work with now on Power, and we could talk about that later. But it was just an incredible experience. He was the right-hand man of one of the main drug dealers who became a suspect in this divisive plan that Omari, playing an undercover cop, was trying to unfold and bring to light and capture the bad guys. So I'm just kind of like a bridge between the two worlds there. And it was really cool. It was a very cool experience. It was a one episode deal, but I got to meet and work with incredible people like Omari, and then became friends, and then that's how it is in this industry. You build relationships, and you take that on with you to the next level.
All right, now here is what we are going to do. We are going to go ahead and show a couple of clips. It's a 3-minute show. We need to find out exactly where you come into this picture. So we're going to go ahead and play this. And when you raise your hands, I will stop there, and then you can talk about it.
Okay.
If you think that you need to talk about some particular scene as it comes to an end, Just raise your hands, I will stop it, and then we can discuss that. So ladies and gentlemen, Vinicius Machado on this dark blue. Let's take a look at this.
So what's in the back?
A stuffed giraffe.
Come on, that was an innocent question. You don't have to be a douche.
Are you neurotic or just plain old stupid? I told you. It's my son's birthday in 2 days.
Yeah? Where'd you lift it?
I bought it.
You bought it? What do you think the street value of Novocaine is, huh?
Not much. Tell us I had the split, all right? I'm driving up to San Francisco for Mickey's birthday.
You going now?
Less traffic at night. Besides, I get some thinking done.
Cool. Sutton showed up.
On their way. Guys, this is Cousin Red. He's not really my cousin, but he does whatever I tell him to do. We have a problem.
Whoa, easy there, Chewbacca.
What's the problem?
Everyone's coming with me.
Why?
Someone's been talking to the cops. Before the night's out, I'm finding out who and making sure he doesn't see the sunrise. You are suspect number one, new guy.
Why me?
I got a pal watching the place. Anything goes down at the Bailey house, you're dead.
And you're crazy, huh? Sutton know you did this?
He doesn't know a thing, and he isn't going to.
Why is that?
Because if Sutton knew there was a snitch, he'd blame me, and I'd be dead.
There's got to be a mistake. I never do anything to hurt you, man. I'm loyal to you. We family. We go way back.
Shut up. Everybody put their phone and wallet and piece on the table. Now! Let's go.
Yes, I'm supposed to be on the cross. My son's birthday tomorrow.
Yeah, send him a card, Varga. You ain't making it. Anyone tries to leave, Cousin Red lights you up.
This is crazy.
I got proof. One of you is talking to the cops.
Proof?
You think I'm a snitch? You think I'm a snitch, lads? You too, Cousin Red? You know how to use that? Come on, take your best shot.
Easy, Devin. If it isn't you, you'll be fine.
Fine? If there's really a snitch, lads, I will personally help you dead the dude.
It's you, isn't it? My mom always told me never trust a quiet guy. Is it really your kid's birthday, or are you gonna go see a cop?
Yeah. I bought him a giraffe, too.
Giraffe.
That's not possible.
Yes. It's true. Everyone knows. I'm sorry.
Eddie Wade's a punk and a liar. If you don't believe us, haul his ass in here and find out for yourself, man.
Very interesting. Vinicius, tell us about this particular episode. It lasted pretty long. So you are the one who is buying the gift for your little boy for the birthday?
Yeah, I actually am actually doing that, but it comes across as though I'm trying to get away with something, especially for, you know, the people involved. They think I'm just trying to leave for the sake of leaving.
Right.
Trying to leave because I'm trying to get away for something, so everybody's, like, suspicious, but obviously Omari playing the undercover cop there, he knows him, but we're not sure of who he is. So, you know, nobody knows who to trust.
Yes.
Is the whole idea there. And Lance, obviously, and I, you know, we've had a lot of history, and but now, you know, the trust issue is coming into play. And so everybody's being questioned and being held hostage at that point where you see in the underground garage. So until the truth comes out, you know, we're going to stay there and figure out who's guilty.
Well, this particular episode, is this part of a TV serial?
Yeah, it's like Dark Blue. It was on TNT.
TNT, okay.
Yeah, it was a very successful show here. It's not on anymore, obviously, but it had a really good run. So I was just privileged to be a part.
Well, you know, ladies and gentlemen, Vinicius was actually done a lot of shows. You know, The Cold Case, where you were the Carlos Garcia. This was in 2003. Is this one of your first early roles?
No, actually, that might be a mistake.
on the typing?
Case was after Nickelodeon. Nickelodeon was the first one I got in 05.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Stop the run, can't stop the run, we can't stop the run.
I don't know, I really have no clue where that came from. Ladies and gentlemen, apologize. There's always technical problems in running these shows. Anyway, go ahead, I'm sorry. Something came up, I don't know how that happened. Vinicius, go ahead.
Yeah, no, so Cold Case is one of the shows I did. Yeah,
okay.
It was a little bit after Nickelodeon.
Okay.
And it was really cool to be a part of that as well.
Okay, there is another one. You acted as the police officer. Sikai Goitan News. What is that exactly?
That was a reenactment,
okay.
A TV series, and I was reenacting an episode of a real live event that had happened, and I was playing a police officer on it. It was for the Japanese television, Nippon TV. It was televised in Japan.
Okay.
Internationally, and I think it was briefly shown here as well, but it didn't have a long run, if it did at all. So don't quote me on that one, but I know for a fact it was an international show, and I just got to be—I got to play a little bit of a different character than I'm used to, because I usually get stereotyped as the gangster, the drug dealer. So playing a police officer was definitely outside of the box for me, so it was really cool.
Yeah, you know, that brings up a very interesting point, because. You know, what is your goal? Are you wanting to be typecasted as a villain in many of the upcoming serials and TVs? Or you want to be an all-round actor who can do comedy, villain, or a hero, or anything else? Or you want to say, wait a minute, I think that I already, people have known me as a villain. Perhaps I should continue in that route. What is your thought on what your future goal should be?
Yeah, I can do everything.
Okay.
Let me just say that flat out. And I have done everything. The problem is that you get stereotyped into what you called here the image, all right, with the bankability. And it's funny because the people don't understand the business from a business standpoint. It's show business for a reason. There's a talent side. And then there's a marketing side. And so within that, you get boxed in because they need to know what to do with you and they need to know what to do with you quick. So you use your strength and, you know, being Latino, being Brazilian, you know, my characteristics and all that automatically puts me into a box. The problem is a lot of people fight to stay in that box, and then people fight because they don't want to stay in that box. I've been blessed with the willingness to embrace that box and make it my own. And now that I've owned it and I've established myself as that, I'm breaking out of that. And I have a few things coming up that you're going to be able to see this year, that you're going to see the transition from there to what I'm going to be doing futurely speaking, which is just about as much as I can, everything, namely. So yes, I can do everything. But I have to play the role of what they are giving me at the point, which is my strength. And that is what has helped me put my foot in the door and to establish myself.
Okay, see, that is, you know, very interesting for me to feel, you know, understand that you realize what the potential is. And you also realize that since you are somewhat boxed in, you don't want to fight getting boxed in. You want to do the best you can and then go on to demonstrate that you not only have ability to act as a villain, you can also act as a comedian. You can do anything you want. So if I were there, if I were one of the powers to be, I would probably put you as a hero in the next movie.
Well, I appreciate that. It's coming. Yeah,
it's coming. It's coming. So, you know, it is absolutely fantastic to listen to your story. Now let's go back and the first break is coming up. Before we do that, there was another couple of things I was looking at. Lincoln Heights. Okay, you were there on that particular show for a couple of episodes. Tell
yes.
our audience exactly how did you know the question I want to ask you is. What is, you know, it is impossible for someone to see all of them, naturally. But nowadays, all these are available on YouTube, not necessarily YouTube, but any shows or any different ways they can go and watch these things. And these are very critical. It looks like you have done a fantastic job on pretty much all of them. Tell our audience about Lincoln Heights and exactly what role did you play and how long did it last and how did you enjoy that particular serial?
I loved Lincoln Heights. I got to work with Michael Riley Burke, Russell Hornsby, actually Bobby Roth, who directed me on Flash Forward, also was the director who I had the immense privilege of working with on Lincoln Heights. He is a phenomenal, phenomenal director doing a lot of things. If you look him up, you'll see. It was such a privilege. I played Juan Trey Garcia. He was the big brother of my sister Dahlia, who got shot.
Okay. All right, hold on 1 second. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, yeah, go ahead. I was trying to load up the Lincoln Heights, that's all.
She gets shot in a drive-by attempt to murder me, and then he retaliates. And that, you know, unfolds his character and his story, and everything develops from there.
I see. So Lincoln Heights, at the early part of the scene, there were little kids that were, the show that I have, there were little kids that were playing. Suddenly somebody shows up, it's just a mayhem. Let's go ahead and play some portions of this. It's only about a minute and 15 seconds. Let me go ahead and play this. And I think you are coming towards the end of that show. But I think it's pretty fascinating to watch how this thing plays out. Ladies and gentlemen, Vinicius Machado on Lincoln Heights. Here it comes.
Dalia! That kid you think shot your sister, stay away from him. You understand?
You understand. Me and my boys, we handle our own business. Whoever shot my sister, pay. That's how the universe works.
Stay away from him, One Trey.
I'm tired too. I don't have time to listen to your family's sob stories. So what, your mom got
beat with tape? Look, call off the hit on the one who shot Dahlia. We'll take care of it, and that's how you get justice.
Don't game me, man. You didn't even get justice for your family. If you lock up that punk who shot my sister, you know he's gonna be out in a few years. Now, no way, that's justice,
look,
man.
You listen to me. Ain't nobody playing games here, all right? Call off the hit and we'll be square. Don't play games with me. You hear what I said? Get him out of here.
Touch you, amigo. Hey, that's an invasion of privacy.
Shut up. Speak.
Hello?
Well, that was fantastic. Really, the acting was perfect. And, you know, you have every quality to be a great actor, and I really wish you all the best. Tell us, our audience, exactly about that scene. And your name is Juan Trey. How did they come up with that name?
I have no idea how they came up with that name. But it was pretty cool. Garcia, obviously, Juan Trey Garcia, mm-hmm. is a common Latino last name. So I'm sure that wasn't hard to do at all. But It was really interesting. So Juan Trey begins to retaliate, and he's looking for the shooter of the person responsible for shooting down his sister. Again, an attempt to murder me. And so the cops intervene and pretty much take me into custody and tell me not to do anything about it. And they pretty much hold me down that way. And then you see in the development of the episode that comes and follows that they actually then utilize, now that the relationship that they have coerced upon me, to utilize me to set up a truce between the two gangs that are having war and that are just causing mayhem all over the city. And then, you know, something interesting happens from there. You have to watch the episode. But it was really cool just to be able to play that. And, you know, being the villain, but also having to be the victim at the same time. It was really cool to be able to display those both colors because he is, you know, being terrorized in a sense by the cops in the way that they are handling the situation with them, because they know that if they don't, he is just going to explode and you know, do really real damage. So they're taking control very, very orderly and very, very wisely. But it was a very cool experience for me and for my character and for me to display some different colors there as well. So.
Excellent. Very, very interesting. You know, and your acting is phenomenal. I really, really see that there's a great potential for you, Vinicius. Well, ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to Global Radio on TV Live. We are going to take a quick break for about 2 minutes or so. And we are going to play something that we normally play in this show or some of the Bollywood music. But this has something to do with Vinicius. And let's find out whether he's able to find out and tell us exactly what this is all about. Ladies and gentlemen, you are listening to Global Radio. My name is Dr. Ravi, and our featured guest is Vinicius. We will be right back. Please stay on the line. All right, ladies and gentlemen, here it is. Well, there is a music going on. We just have to figure out how the sound comes up. All right, let's see what we have. It's very hard to listen to this without music. Let's see what we can do. Ladies and gentlemen, there is some music going on, and unfortunately there is some technical trouble here, so we will continue to fix this in a couple of seconds.
I just want to get in there and dance with them.
Yeah, really? Yeah. Let me get this. Give me a second here. We will fix it. Just a matter of time now. There you go, guys. Here we go.
Here we go.
ओरी छोरी मान भी ले बात मोरी मैंने प्यार तुझसे है किया हो तेरे बिन में जिया तो क्या जिया हो तेरे नैनों में ये जो काजल है सपनों का बादल है मन तेरे ही कारण पागल है ओ गोरिया Thank you.
speaks a thousand words, I feel eternal bliss. The roses pout their scarlet mouths like offering a kiss. No drop of rain, no glowing flame has ever been so pure. If being in love can feel like this, then I'm in love for sure.
आई है जवान पर मोर दिल में कहीं एक तीर जो था आया है कमान पर
सुन सुन रे सजन रहे जन्म जन्म हम प्रेम नगर के वासी थामे थामे हाथ रहे साथ साथ कभी दूरी हो न जरा सी चलूं मैं संग संग तेरी राह में बस तेरी चाह में ओ रे छोरी
ओ रे छोरी
Ladies and gentlemen, all good things have to come to an end. You know, unfortunately, that beautiful frame was gone, and we enjoyed Vinicius dancing so delightfully for the Bollywood music. That's fantastic. Vinicius, welcome back to our second segment.
Thank you for having me back again. I thoroughly enjoyed that Bollywood. It was amazing.
All right. Listen, tell me exactly, were you able to recognize where that was, the dancers? By the way, one thing I have to tell you, though, your Brazilian women are beautiful.
Thank you. We are known for that. Huh? Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.
That place is Copacabana Beach?
Yes, yes. It's Copacabana in Rio de Janeiro, Rio de Janeiro.
Uh-huh.
Bollywood. It was a flash mob right in the middle of the street, right by the beach. Beautiful.
Very good. So, you know, that's why we wanted to play that, so that there is a connection between you and those dancers and the place that where you grew up. Anyway, well, let's get back to you. The next one that I wanted to talk about, and, you know, we are coming to, you know, the pretty much last 15 minutes of the show. You know, the time is flying by when you have somebody of this great talent. Is able to not only talk to us like this, but also entertain us with a little bit of dance moves. That's fantastic. The Shield. Tell us, our audience, about Shield. Exactly what that particular episodes are all about.
So the Shield was another hit show here in the U.S. And I had the amazing privilege of working with Michael Chiklis, whom I, you know, known now for a little bit of time and became friends and have run into in so many different events. And the character I was playing on that was a massive, massive murderer who is a Salvadorian and who instigated the massive murder of a whole city of Mexican people.
Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, and so in the episode that you're going to see, I don't know if you have clips of that.
Or... I have the clips of that, and you know this particular clip. What we should do, we should go ahead and play the clip first, and then okay. You can go ahead and explain to our audience exactly what the scene is all about, and also you know how you got this part and all the other people you worked with. So, ladies and gentlemen, here is Vinicius Machado on The Shield. Let's take a look.
Okay.
Can you step out front so we can talk to you, please?
I'm on legal, man. They released me early. I got papers and everything.
You know, you're free and clear.
Then talk to my ass.
Oh. Bring it out the front. And shoot the shit.
No. Now you can come on your own, but I can drag you through your friend's blood. This is your last chance to save yourself. You give me names, I recommend to the judge you do your time in a safe place.
A safe place?
Yeah. I can't drop you off in Bizland, but word that you're the killer is gonna hit the Mexican side of the street if it hasn't already.
Means I need my own people to keep my back.
Unless I can convince Santi and the rest of the Mexis that you didn't do it. It takes your hood price off the street. You give us the other killers for immunity, and you can start scheduling your next welcome home party.
You can convince the weapons.
Count on it.
I gotta hear it with my own ears.
No problem. These names better check out.
They will. So when do I get out of here?
Answers first. Why'd you kill those people at San Marcos?
Something big's coming up. I didn't get too much details. All I know is we were cut out by the Mexicans and people are pissed off.
Who ordered you to do it?
Wardo. He said we were sending a message. Kill everybody in the house, jungle style. There's a dude by the name of Romero. We're supposed to leave him alive.
So you just cut off his arm?
You know a guy named Cruz Pizuela?
Nah, don't know.
Okay, stay put. It's gonna take a while to get you sprung.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, there it is, The Shield. Vinicius, tell us, our audience, you know, something that I found very interesting about that particular episode. You have...
Previously on The Shield.
Screwed. My ex-wife.
So in many of the different shows, I noticed that you are able to change your accent. That one has a very significant Latino accent. And, you know, when you're talking to me, you don't have much of any accent at all. So this is part of your training. And before you answer that, tell us about the Shield part of it.
Yeah, so obviously playing like a Salvadorian there who was the instigator and the killer for the murder of a lot of Mexicans. And I'm being held hostage now for it. It's actually a protective service thing that the guy playing the cop, Michael Chiklis, Vic, is utilizing to his advantage to get me to usher out some more information about my dealings, which I do, but it's all a lie. So he's lying to me back and forth as well. So if you watch the episode, you'll see how it plays out, where he promises to get me out if I do a few things.
What was I supposed to do?
And then he actually...
Sorry, go ahead, yeah.
So that's the character that I was playing there. And I actually had another episode on that, on The Shield. So that it's that. And part of the training is obviously to for me to be able to change my accents. Yes, absolutely. And I don't know if you notice as well, I tend to change my appearance a lot as well. You know, from different shades of the beard, or how I, you know, utilize my facial hair to my actual hair, and the different textures and the different styles. Everything is a part of the process of transforming myself and emulating that soul, that spirit, that life that I'm portraying. So everything counts.
Oh, absolutely. You know, so you are, you know, the changing the face, and I'm growing a mustache or beard, those are somewhat easier because you have a perfect face. You know, you can, you know, people can change your face to make you look like practically anybody. But in my experience, and I'm not an actor, but in my experience, I realized that changing the voice, and you know, I noticed that in many of the episodes that we were watching, there is a distinct difference between each one of those individuals. You know, the last one was very thick, different South American type accent, and you know, everywhere else it was different. So you do have a voice coach?
I do, actually, yes. And you know, the interesting thing is that a lot of times these characters, they're written just black and white. They're just stereotypical gangsters. You know, they may vary from demographics. and you know, age range and things like that, but they're just black and white. So you try to, and this is what I was telling you earlier, that I've embraced that box and I've tried to make it my own to bring a fresh and new approach to it so that it's not redundant and, you know, boring for me in that sense where I'm having to do the exact same thing over and over, but also for the audience, for me to be able to reveal and to show that, you know, I can go to the extreme with it, and I can become a chameleon, and I can really transform myself and display some acting ability within that. So a lot of the times, the little nuances, as such as like a little accent, is not written. You know, sometimes they ask you for it. Sometimes they're very particular, but most of the time they don't. So you offer that, you know, and you hope that they're going to accept it. And then, you know, I'm very grateful that you've been able to recognize it and to point it out today. So I appreciate that. Thank you.
Oh, most welcome. The next one I want to show you, I think, let's take a look. I just want to show the first part of the screen. Now, this lady, I found it in the YouTube, and she's talking about you. And I think she's making the introduction. Who is she? Or how did you get into this?
Valerie Ortiz. Okay. I actually know her all the way back from high school.
Okay.
Remember how I told you I was in a drama class? And well, she was in the drama magnet program that I eventually joined in my high school. And we actually did a play together called West Side Story. And she is a phenomenal, phenomenal actress. She's on VH1's, what is the name of the show now?
Anyway, it will come to you.
It will. It just escaped my mind right now. I'm so sorry. It's a hit show on VH1. She plays a very edgy cheerleader. And she's done numerous of other things, from, you know, big, huge feature films to other TV shows like South of Nowhere and all that. She's an incredible human being, a personal friend. And she is the host of that TV show, American Latino TV. And I was one of the guests being interviewed in that particular episode where she's talking about me. So,
well, let's listen to the American Latino host. And she's doing a very good job. Let's listen to this.
And next, we join rising actor Vinicius Machado. He is a co-star in the new series, Power, which airs on Stars. The series follows the owner of a popular New York City nightclub who is also the boss of one of the city's biggest criminal organizations. Vinicius plays a high-ranking member of the gang who is dating his boss's daughter and becomes counterintelligence in the FBI's pursuit of their most wanted. Now, for more on this breakout role, here is Vinicius Machado on American Latino TV.
Val San Felices. ¿Estás conectado con Lobos?
No sé quién es. Vaya si su casa antes que te lastime.
Vinicius Machado is one of television's fastest rising Latino talents. After various small roles on hit shows like The Shield and CSI, and what separates Vinicius from many other performers is his ability to make three-dimensional humans out of two-dimensional characters.
The stereotype is always, you know, a big hurdle, but, you know, a lot of people, they have a hard time accepting that. I embrace it, you know, wholeheartedly. You know, I'm enjoying incorporating different elements of not trying to be cliche, but, you know, finding a fresh way to approach that stereotype and redefining it, really. I was born in Brazil. During my high school years, I had to take an elective in school in which I didn't like drawing or things like that, so I chose drama. Just for kicks and giggles. From there, went to Universal Studios, auditioned there. I got in with the first audition. Just, you know, one thing led to the next. Became an actor. I moved to California. My first few auditions, one of them was Ned's Declassified, and I got it, you know, as the Brazilian foreign exchange student. It was literally written for me. I mean, yeah, it couldn't have been a more perfect fit. And here I am today, the rest is history.
Now, Vinicius gets a chance to redefine the gangster role as most know it on television in what promises to be a breakout role on the new Starz series, Power.
Power is about a nightclub owner called Ghost, James St. Patrick, who is a New York club owner who's living a double life. I play Nomar Arciello. He's a New Rican gang member of the Soldado Nation.
You're gonna talk to me about this guy who got a foot in the mail last week. I need to know what I'm dealing with.
That guy got a foot? I heard Ruiz got a head.
The character that I play, he's in this position now where he's got this 14-year-old daughter of his boss who he's having a relationship with that is being used as a blackmailing tool by the FBI to utilize his position in the gang world to advance their progress. And I just find myself deeper and deeper into a pickle that I can't get myself out of. You got a dream? Don't let anybody tell you you can't make it. You can do it, you know, but you gotta have the determination to see the good and the bad out of what the objective is going to bring. And then just to endure the process. Love it, you know, and don't settle.
Absolutely perfect. You know, you have a dream, you have to follow your dream, and no matter what happens, continue to pursue it. And it's a great lesson for everyone listening to this show. And our worldwide audience are really
this next segment
happy.
Is called Superstar and Actor.
All right, there we go. You know, there is always some technical problems because in the heat of the moment, I forget to turn the other one off, and then that thing goes off. Anyway, that's why this is a very informal program, you know. But anyway, I really, Vinicius, I really enjoyed that part that you came up with, where you had a different people doing different work. So in that regard, tell us our audience, what is your future progress here? What is he planning to do next? Because you have seen various different types of activities so far. What are you planning to do next? That is the most important thing we need to know.
Well, I have a lot in the works, actually. I have three new feature films coming out in 2015. I'm currently filming two new projects, which I cannot mention, unfortunately. But I've been producing for the past 2 years now, and I will continue to do that. What I want to do is to be able to now move into opening doors for people of color like myself in such a way that Hollywood would recognize us not as a minority or a stereotype, but that we would get to a level that we would be accepted as actors. Whatever the skin color you have, wherever you come from, if you are talented and you can be a leading man, doesn't matter anything else, you can be that. That's my goal, to establish that, to get myself to that level, to continue to produce and open up doors for Latino and for other people of other races and colors of the same, leading the way in that way so that we can get to a better place and influence the whole world that way.
So what you are saying is very interesting, because if you are going to achieve your goal, which I am sure 100% that you are, even guys like me has a leading role possibility.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not holding my breath, but you know, that's a very good thing, you know, for upcoming generations, and you know, as you said, the people of different race and color, the Hollywood should open up. By the way, if you have any problem opening a Hollywood, I can open up the Bollywood for you.
I would love to be in Bollywood again. Yes.
Okay, so let's do the you know, one of these days our Bollywood audience, because we have a huge Bollywood audience, and you would perfectly fit into this. All you have to do is you don't have to speak Hindi or any other Indian language. You just move your mouth and they will dub it.
I love it. I'm there.
You are there. Okay. Well, let me see if I can do something. You know, it is. You know, it is one of the biggest after Hollywood. That is the biggest one, and they have thousands of movies being made. They're always looking for actors and actresses from outside of the Indian subcontinent, and especially persons like you. You know, they do have some Hollywood actors come and play there, some smaller roles. And some of the Bollywood actors come to Hollywood and do as well. That particular music you heard, okay, now that was a music that was created by one of the music directors who got a couple of Oscar awards from the American Oscar. So, So they have done a reasonably good job. But anyway, notwithstanding that, we are going to go back and look at. You know, you are the one that you said you were dating the boss's daughter. There was somebody else I saw. I want to see whether this particular one has that famous actor was there in that. Let me see if I can pull this up, and we can close the show by looking at this particular episode. Let's see what we have. Just a minute.
No problem.
Well, there is an advertisement start, which you will get rid of.
How do you turn an idea?
You're listening to the...
Is this something... are you familiar with this one, AfterBuzz TV?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I was on a show.
There are a couple of episodes I saw. See, here is where you are. Let's take a look.
Save his own life based on, you know, the blackmailing and all that. But it's so interesting because Nomar is like Madison Square Garden, right? He just like he's approachable to everybody, and he knows how to handle everybody, you know, and he knows how to, you know, just embrace, you know, everything that comes his way in a sense. So he's sensitive and he's naive that way, you know. But at the same time, he's very powerful because, you know, he just allows anybody to come in.
Mm. And your character is also very quick on his feet. I liked how when you got up and you finally went to the door, start eavesdropping with.
All right, so. That is TV radio talk show that you appeared and answered some of the questions.
Yes. AfterBuzz.
AfterBuzz, okay. Do you have a lot of similar activities going on throughout the year?
Yeah, I do actually. I've got several of them. A few events coming up as we speak this month. Some next month. I'm going to be appearing at the Ice-T and Coco's Aquarius All-Star Bash.
Okay.
February 14th in New York City. I'm going to be doing Fashion Week that week, the All-Star Games. I have a few events to attend here this month in LA. I was invited to the premiere viewing party screening of Empire, which is Competition to Power.
Okay.
And that is actually tonight.
Tell us about this. What time is the show actually on which channel?
It is coming on at 9/8 Central tonight. And the channel, I am going to have to get back to you on that. I am
okay.
Not completely sure right now.
Yeah, no problem. Okay, very good. You know, we have pretty much come to the conclusion of the show. And I think that whatever I have seen so far, it's quite fascinating. And everything that you have done in your life, until up to this point, has really propelled you to be one of the best Hollywood actors. And I see that you are very young. And you have a long, you know, time ahead of you, and there is a lot of great potential that I can see that you can complete in the next few years to few decades. I also noticed you have some charity. Now, tell our audience, how did you get involved with this charity, and if they want to contribute to this, what they should do?
Yeah, Feed the Children and World Vision. It's always been a passion of my kids. It's perhaps why I have so many. But I actually started funding Feed the Children all the way back when I was living with my mom still back in high school.
Uh-huh.
And I just had a profound guilt within my soul that, you know, we as a society, we as human beings could allow children of any kind, of any age, of any race, anywhere in the world, to go hungry. And so I decided to do something about that, and I knew I couldn't change the whole spectrum of it by myself, but I could begin to affect change little by little, and that's what I sought to do. And I've been doing that ever since, you know. Feed the Children, World Vision.
World Vision do? World Vision is, what is the charitable goal for World Vision?
Yeah, it's hunger as well. It's a little bit more broad than Feed the Children, but it also provides kids, you know, so it also helps out kids as well.
Well, you know, we have not covered a lot of other subject matters. For example, you also had a little comedy part in the Get Smart with Steve Carell and many other things. So what we would like to do is to have you come back in a few months after we find out exactly what programs you will be on and what movies you have signed up. Hopefully you will give us, our audience, another hour or so of your precious time, and we will continue this conversation in a few months. And I wish you all the best, and our audience also wish you all the best, and we will go ahead and post this in our website, and so therefore people can see it, and we'll also send a link to you. Ladies and gentlemen, and thank you so much, Vinicius.
Thank you, Dr. Rabbi. Thank you so much for having me on. It's been a pleasure. Looking forward to coming back, and make sure you guys watch Global Radio TV.
Excellent, man. He's plugging in for me. That's great. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we will be right back. And Vinicius, please stay on the line for a couple of more minutes.
Sure. Okay.